Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I'm very happy to be there for that second edition of the Effect Days. I hope you're having a great conference day. And you know, it's kind of funny because I'm talking about, you know, power and concurrency. And also, I'm a huge fan of Lord of the Rings. So, Tim, we might become friends after the talk. Sorry about that. Yeah, okay. And yeah, so today I'm going to talk about, you know, the issues we deal with concurrency, and we will see how Effect with its structured concurrency model helps addressing these problems. So very quickly, let me introduce myself. So my name is Antoine. I'm currently working as a freelance software engineer for my own company. And my goal there is to help other companies build successful products. And I'm also involved in the open source development. So I've been around in the Effect ecosystem for a while now. And yeah, I'm also organizing the Paris TypeScript, the Effect Paris meetup, sorry. So you can find me on these links. And yeah, I'd be happy to chat about this project. So why do we need to care about concurrency, right? And the issue is that concurrency is quite complex, and I believe speakers today showed how complex it is to get it right. And even though in JavaScript we have the event loop model that provides us good abstractions over concurrency, we still have many challenges, right, that are left to us. So we still have some work to do, right? We need to put some work. So yeah, let's see a few problems we face with JavaScript and concurrency and promises, right? And obviously it's not exhaustive, right? We have many other problems, but let's just see a few of them. So the first one is that whenever you come to await a promise, you kind of lose the execution control over it. So if you want to exit from that situation, you don't really have any ways of doing that. And the issue is that you might end up, you know, leaking resources or just deadlocking them, as you never reach, you know, the final block for these promises, for these works. The other issue I want to go through is with the famous promise.all that you might know. And the first issue we have with promise.all is that it doesn't offer us a good way to have control over the concurrent execution. So it's unbounded by default, so everything gets fired concurrently, and you might have issues with that. So be careful with it within your programs. And the other issue that might be the most important one is that whenever some of these promises fail, right, the other ones keep running in the background. So the control flow is provided back, but indeed we have still resources and we keep in memory a lot of promises and all the resources that are associated with them. So in that case, as you can see, like up until the point where we reach the 5 seconds timer, then the other one, like the set timeout of 20 seconds, will keep running in the background. And so now the question is, do we have solutions for that problem? Well, we can talk about, you know, the explicit resource management feature that is pretty new in the ecosystem. And while that one is helpful to model some kind of explicit resource release, it's more or less nothing but a more convenient way of having try finally statements, right? It doesn't offer new guarantees about interruption and resources releases. So we're still bound to the fact that the promise needs to settle, and then we can exit the scope so that resources can then be released. The other one is the abort controller API, and we've been talking about that as well. And why that one is helpful, as it helps us modeling some kind of cancellation, then the issue is that we don't really have guarantees that this cancellation will occur, because the receiver of these signals need to correctly handle the cleanup and also need to propagate these events to all the children operations. So it's pretty tedious to maintain and to like put these guarantees into reality. So now that we saw some of the problems we have with concurrency, we can talk about a solution that is called structured concurrency. And what's good about structured concurrency is that it helps us modeling a graph of operation where all the parents fully manage all the children operations. So we manage the lifetime and also you know, all the scopes linked to all the children operations. So in the context of structured concurrency, all the operations have well-defined rules and well-defined lifetime that you can rely upon. And really, you can think of structured concurrency as the way an operating system needs to work, right? When you have a process and that process like gets terminated for some reason, then you expect all the threads and all the tasks associated with that thread to be canceled as well, right? We don't expect any orphaned task to be running in the background. And really, also a small disclaimer, structured concurrency is not a new concept at all, and it's just gaining some momentum and some popularity. Some of the like modern programming languages, I don't know if you can call Java modern programming language, but still, it has the merit of implementing such features. So really, it's like a broad concept that is gaining some adoption more and more in the ecosystem. And you know, if something is nice and powerful, you can be pretty sure it's already baked in into Effect. So Effect makes structured concurrency available for TypeScript, and that's really good news, right? And one example of that is on the right, you can see that we're using effect.all, which is the equivalent, the better equivalent of promise.all with Effect. And the good point is that because we're using structured concurrency, whenever we interrupt, right, the program, then all the children operation get correctly interrupted. And we have an opportunity for each of these operations to execute the release of these resources, so on the left. And so as you can see, well, everything interrupts just correctly, and we don't leave anything behind us. And also a good point with structured concurrency, just putting aside all the guarantees it provides us, is the nice and declarative API it offers us to have a control over the execution. So whether you need to make a function concurrent, like you need to opt in for concurrency, for a specific kind of concurrency, or if you want to keep it sequential, then you just keep the same API, right? We don't have any changes to do. So that's really also a good key point that structured concurrency provides us. And a good thing is that everything happens behind the scenes, right? We don't need to really care about it. Like everything is managed by the runtime by default. So now that we see what was structured concurrency in practice, I want to go through a bit into some of the principles that are used by structured concurrency. And that principle is called supervision. And supervision, you can see it as really the strategy that is adopted by the runtime to kind of manage the lifetime of all the operations. And by default, we have what we call the automatic supervision, which is basically that the parent manages the children operation. So that was showed in the previous example. So that happened like automatically, and also with fibers, as we can see in that example. Whenever we have some kind of background fiber that is forked, then what happens when the parent fiber exits? Then you have it in example there. We just see that whenever the parent terminates, then the children gets automatically interrupted. And if for some reason you want to escape that kind of supervision, so in other words, you want fibers to be outliving their parents, then you can use other ways of forking fibers. In other words, you can use different ways of managing their lifetime. And we've seen some examples using fork scoped and forking in some of the talks, and I'm really glad we saw that. And the issue, the good thing is that whenever you come to fork into scopes, then you just delegate the lifetime, the management of the lifetime to scopes and not to parent fibers anymore. So you can kind of decorrelate, but you still kind of preserve all the principle of structured concurrency. It's just that you don't have the same parents anymore. And so now you might be wondering, all right, so we've been talking about structured concurrency and we've been talking about fibers. And what's the relationship between the two, right? And the thing is that to implement structured concurrency, you need some kind of strong primitive to implement all these principles, right? And it turns out that fibers are really a good candidate for such implementation, as they are lightweight and non-blocking. So it means that to deal with the concurrency and the world of a program that needs to have many, many operations at the same time, you can really have fibers representing all this operation without a problem. And also fibers encode some kind of state, so whether they are interrupted or like they have exited or whatever, they can embed information that we need to deal with that. And also they are scoped so they can preserve all the relationships they have between all the fibers. So that's really a good point that we can have that already baked in effect. And just as a side note, you can have structured concurrency without fibers, right? But fibers like overcome all these issues and even go beyond the scope of structured concurrency, right? So it's really a win duo on that side. So that's it for me. It was structured concurrency in 10 minutes. If you want to go a bit more into the details of what it is, there is some links. I really encourage you to go through these links and also to see a bit more what's running behind the scenes of Effect, and you might benefit from that also in other ecosystems.